stretched high into the air, but something held me always there. No escape, but I don't mind.
You know that feeling, right? Gravity. You drop something, it falls. Simple. That feeling of weight keeping you grounded.
Yeah, it feels totally fundamental, doesn't it? Newton's apple, Einstein's curved spacetime. That's how we usually think about it.
But what if that whole picture, our basic understanding, is actually, well, inverted?
It's a wild thought. And that's exactly what we're diving into today. Something really out there called the Cosmic Influx Theory, or CIT.
Right, CIT. Our mission today is to unpack this because it completely flips the script on gravity, on how the universe expands, even on what matter is.
Yeah, the core idea is that everything, and I mean everything, particles, planets, galaxies, is constantly growing, gaining mass and energy.
Continuously. Whoa.
Continuously. And what's really interesting, I think, is how this theory even came about. It wasn't just one person in a lab.
Yeah, the AI part. That's fascinating.
Totally. It's based on papers developed by a researcher working with ChatGPT. It's this amazing blend of, you know, human intuition and AI's analytical power.
Really pushing the envelope of how science might get done. All right, so let's start with the big one. Gravity. We think pull, right?
That's the textbook version. Objects attract, or mass bends space-time, and things follow the curves.
But CIT says, no pull.
No pull. It suggests gravity is actually a push. Imagine this universal energy field, like an ether, constantly streaming inwards, pressing down on everything.
Well, from all sides. Is that a new idea?
Well, not entirely new. There was an old idea, Lesage's theory, about push gravity. CIT kind of dusts that off, but gives it a whole new modern physics twist.
So when I feel weight or see a stone fall, it's not being pulled. It's being pushed by this cosmic stream.
That's the core concept. And it's not just some vague pressure. The theory calls it a measurable volumetric acceleration, a kind of directed momentum transfer happening all the time.
Okay, measurable. How? What's the mechanism?
Right. This is where it gets really interesting. It involves the Lorentz transformation of mass energy, LTME.
Know that one, ECR and all that.
Yeah.
Usually for particles going super fast, near light speed, their mass increases.
Exactly. But here's the radical part. CIT claims LTME isn't just for tiny particles at relativistic speeds. It applies to big things too, like planets, stars, even at much lower velocities.
Wait, even our solar system moving relatively slowly through space?
That's the assertion. And here's the kicker. They looked at the gamma factor from LTME. That's the bit that quantifies the mass energy increase.
Okay.
And they calculated the root mean square velocity, the sort of average speed of our whole solar system. It's about 12.3 kilometers per second. They think that might be the speed of the original gas cloud everything formed from.
Right, the protoplanetary disk speed. So what?
So if you plug that specific velocity into the gamma factor calculation,
yeah,
and then you do something simple, just take the result, subtract one, and divide by four.
Let me guess.
You get a number incredibly close to Newton's gravitational constant, G.
Wow. Okay.
It's acting like pressure on a surface area, pressing in from all directions.
Mm.
It implies this isn't just a coincidence, but maybe reveals G isn't fundamental, but emerges from motion and this energy influx.
So for you listening, this basically flips gravity on its head. It's not a pull from inside matter, but potentially a constant cosmic push from outside. That's a lot to take in.
It really is. And this idea of a constant influx, it doesn't just stop at gravity. It connects directly to how we see the whole universe expanding.
How so? Extension seems like a separate thing.
Well, remember Einstein's field equations? There's a term in there, the kappa function. It involves G in the speed. CIT looks at kappa and says, maybe it's not just a constant coupling factor. Maybe it's actually a universal expansion factor. And it's deeply linked to the Hubble parameter, the rate the universe expands.
So G itself, the gravitational constant, might be tied up with the Hubble expansion. That connects local gravity to the whole cosmic scale.
Exactly. CIT suggests you can even express G as a product involving the Hubble parameter. It implies a really deep connection.
What's the specific link there?
If you take the Hubble parameter, they use a value around 67.8 kilometers per megaparsec, and multiply it by the speed of light, you get an acceleration value.
Okay.
That value matches the acceleration we see at the edge of the observable universe. But CIT proposes this acceleration isn't just out there. It's everywhere. Universal. Even happening inside atoms, driving continuous growth.
Which brings us neatly, if controversially, to the expanding Earth idea.
Ah, yes, the expanding Earth hypothesis. Mainstream science mostly sidelined that idea, right? People felt there wasn't enough evidence, or preferred other explanations like tidal forces or internal heat dynamics.
But CIT argues...
What?
That this influx is the mechanism.
Precisely. The theory argues that this continuous energy absorption by Earth directly causes its mass and energy to increase. And that increase is what we see as geological activity.
You mean things like the Earth's internal heat, volcanoes erupting, earthquakes, the ocean floor spreading at ridges, continents drifting, even Earth spin, all driven by absorbing cosmic energy.
That's the proposal. It's presented as a direct consequence of the planet constantly soaking up this influx. It would fundamentally change how we view Earth sciences.
Are there other observations supporting this?
Well, consider the fact that orbits seem to be slightly increasing. The Earth-Sun distance is growing by, estimates vary, maybe 5 to 14 meters per century.
Huh. I thought that was just measurement uncertainty or solar wind pressure.
Could be, but interestingly, that rate actually lines up pretty well with calculations based on the Hubble parameter if you assume mass energy increase. Same for the moon moving away from Earth. CIT suggests it's not just tides, but also this mass gain effect.
Okay, let's just pause on that. So the universe expanding isn't only galaxies flying apart. It might mean matter itself, planets included, are actively growing. That's a dynamic Earth, all right.
And it doesn't stop at just our solar system. This idea of influx and growth shapes how planets form everywhere. CIT talks about a preferred distance, dpref.
A sweet spot in the protoplanetary disk.
Exactly. A specific distance from the star where the theory predicts the biggest planets should naturally form based on fundamental laws. It's not just guessing.
And how is this dpref calculated? What's it linked to?
This is where it gets even more interconnected. Dpref is linked mathematically, not just to gravity stuff like G and that VRMS velocity, but also, really surprisingly, to electromagnetic constants.
Gravity and electromagnetism linked through where planets form, that's bridging huge gaps in physics.
It is. And there's even a weird numerical link to how the ampere, the unit of current, used to be defined. It suggests maybe these forces aren't so separate deep down.
So does this help us with finding planets out there, exoplanets?
Well, that's the hope. Could we use this dpref idea, maybe combined with data from telescopes like James Webb, to predict where massive planets should be? JWST is definitely seeing lots of growing-looking objects, galaxies, stars, planets, which seems to fit the energy absorption idea.
What about those weird exoplanets? The ones super close to their stars, whipping around in days?
CIT has an interesting take on that. It suggests maybe two types. Some could be really old planets, seeing as they were billions of years ago when they were much smaller, so they look like they orbit faster relative to their size then.
Like looking back in time.
Right. Or they could be genuinely young, newborn planets formed close in that are still small but will grow bigger over cosmic time. This challenges the usual view that orbital period isn't really related to the star's age. It paints this picture of planets as active growing systems, not just static balls of rock or gas.
Okay, this is really stretching the connections now, from planets to atoms.
This might be the most speculative, but also maybe the most profound part. The theory highlights striking similarities between atomic structures and solar systems.
You mean like mostly empty space in both? Forces involved gravity versus electric, orbits, spin, magnetic fields.
All of that. Scale differences obviously are immense, but also things like angular momentum, wave properties, even light bending near masses, and shared objects, electrons, and molecules, maybe planets shared between stars. It even compares the cosmic web structure to electron clouds.
So what's the big implication here? It's just an analogy, right?
Well, CIT takes it further. If all matter is constantly gaining mass energy from the influx, then theoretically, over billions and billions of years, an atom could grow to resemble a planet. A nucleus could grow to resemble a star.
You're saying the lines blur between quantum and classical scales.
That's the extreme extrapolation, yeah.
Yeah.
It challenges that hard boundary we usually assume.
Okay, if this influx is real, what's carrying it? What is the influx made of?
Good question. The theory needs actual carriers. It posits these things called primordial elementary whirlings, or PUWs. Real particles, thermodynamically defined.
PQWs, what are they like?
Their calculated mass, derived from the cosmic microwave background temperature, turns out to be incredibly close to the estimated mass of an electron.
Really? Like electrons?
Similar mass, yeah.
Yeah.
And they share properties with neutrinos. Tiny mass, super fast, barely interact with anything. But here's the crucial difference for CIT. It's not about PPWs just bouncing off or being blocked by matter. It's about matter absorbing them. That absorption is what supposedly generates the push of gravity.
So the particles making up you, me, everything, they could be constantly absorbing these PUWs and growing.
In this model, yes. A constant, subtle increase in mass energy at the most fundamental level.
Mind blown. Okay, so how on earth do you test something this huge? Do we need giant new colliders or telescopes?
Maybe not exclusively. What's interesting is that CLT suggests we might already have the evidence, we just need to reinterpret existing observations.
Like what? Everyday stuff?
Potentially.
Yeah.
Think about an accelerometer, the thing in your phone that detects motion and orientation. It measures acceleration.
Right.
CIT proposes that maybe, just maybe, what it's actually detecting is the constant downward pressure of this PEW influx stream, not just a pull from Earth's gravity in the traditional sense.
So my phone might be detecting cosmic push. Okay.
Yeah.
What else?
Quantum stuff. The Casimir effect, you know, where two plates close together in a vacuum attract, usually explained by vacuum fluctuations.
Yeah.
CIT suggests it could be reinterpreted as differential pressure from the influx. Fewer PUWs getting between the plates means more push from the outside. Same idea could apply to van der Waals forces between molecules.
Reinterpreting quantum phenomena. Bold.
Yeah.
Any really simple example?
Maybe even things like dew forming on a leaf, or frost, or just raindrops falling. The idea is that a mass, the leaf, the Earth absorbs influx energy, and this somehow drags or causes water molecules or droplets to move towards it. It's a very different way to look at common phenomena.
Wow. So if this holds water, every time you drop your keys, you're not just seeing gravity pull them down, you're witnessing a direct effect of this universal cosmic energy flow pushing them down.
It reframes everything, doesn't it? Suddenly the mundane becomes evidence for a universe-shaping process.
Absolutely. So, wrapping this up, the cosmic influx theory is, well, it's audacious. It paints a picture of a universe where gravity is a push.
Matter is constantly growing, absorbing energy.
Cosmic expansion and local physics, like Earth's geology, are deeply linked.
And the micro and macro scales, atoms and solar systems, might share fundamental growth principles.
All driven by this universal energy influx carried by these PEW particles.
It's a complete package, a whole new framework.
And this deep dive, drawing heavily on that unique human-AI collaboration, really invites you, the listener, to just think about it, to question assumptions. It shows how science is always evolving, sometimes in really unexpected directions.
Absolutely. So maybe the age-old question isn't, why does the stone fall? CIT flips it. Maybe the real question is, why do we let go of the stone into this constant universal flow?
Suggesting gravity isn't some mysterious force pulling us, but just the background reality, this omnipresent energy stream defining mass and existence.
Exactly. And it leaves you with a really provocative final thought. What if the constants we build our physics on, like G, aren't truly constant? What if they're dynamic, evolving parts of this grand cosmic influx?
Mm-hmm.
What would that mean for everything else?
That keeps me sane, it holds me here, so I survive. The influx flows, keeps me alive.